Welcome back to Sunday Morning Quickies, episode 104 for the 19th of November, 2023. Before we get going this week, I just want to throw out a special happy birthday to my dear friend Dorothea Jane Fisher. Doree and I have known each other since 1975. Yeah, we go way back. But anyway, Doree, love you dearly. Happy birthday, kiddo. This week, for our hands-on segment, I want to talk a little bit about some more tool things. I've had quite a few questions this week about some of the tools that we use on the bench and some of the tools that we use off the bench, meaning the buffing and polishing machine that Liz and I use. Now, I recently, I don't remember if it was in a video or in a comment to a video, posted a link to the this machine here from Ferree's tool. That's a Model 99B bench motor with Jacob's chuck. And I did warn people that if you want to get one of these, you're gonna have to give up a body part, at least a spleen, perhaps a kidney. They're very expensive. Now, we've had ours for over 30 years now. We got them back when they were a lot less, about a third of the price that they are now. But back 30 years ago, a third of the price of what they are now was still some serious money. Anyway, there are other alternatives to that. Now, I had an email today from Karen, and Karen had asked if this device would be okay, would be a good substitute for cleaning up hardware and cleaning up small parts. And, well, here's the problem that I see with it. Number one, the listing on Amazon does not tell you what size the Jacob's chuck is, but judging from the size of the motor shown in the pictures, I'm thinking that's either a quarter inch or maybe a 3/8 inch Jacob's chuck, and no, that's not going to be big enough. The motor itself isn't going to have the torque that is required to do proper buffing or proper cleaning. And actually, Liz and I were at breakfast this morning after we dropped her car off to get some work done at the local Nissan dealer. And that's when I was reading the email from Karen. And I went and I looked at the link. I figured out what it was, and I went to the Amazon listing. And at that price point, it's $79. At that price point, you're not going to find something that's got the kind of torque, especially when it's coming with a chuck and stuff like that attached to it. The specs say it's variable speed, and I believe it was like 80 RPM through 10,000. And right there, that's a red flag, because that's not gonna make it. So no, you see those inexpensive, cheap machines, as tempting as it may be, save your money. A good buffing motor is going to be at least a quarter of a horsepower, if not more. We really don't want one that's turning at 3450 RPM. We really want one turning at 1720 RPM. You want a slower turning one. And you definitely want something that you can put a chuck on to do this. Now, there are other ways of doing it. If you have a small benchtop drill press, that'll work too. Or a floor model drill press. But even a small benchtop drill press, as long as it's got a half-inch chuck, you can do the hardware the way I do the hardware. And it's not just for polishing purposes and stuff like that. We can also clean up chowdering of screw heads. You can do all sorts of stuff with a machine where you can chuck the hardware in. Now, the bench motor that Liz and I have on the right-hand side, it has the half-inch Jacobs chuck, and it has a handbrake on it, which is really nice. And it's running with a foot switch. On the left-hand side, there's a tapered spindle that you can put buffing wheels on. And it has sufficient testicular fortitude where you can put a 6-inch buffing wheel on there and get in there and get some power behind it and get some force behind it and really, really work the part. And we have a catch thing, so if we lose a part, it gets captured. It doesn't go flying across the room, or worse yet, through the sheetrock. But anyway, so there's a lot of options you have available. But if you don't have the ability to put, mount something to a bench, and believe me, a good motor is going to need to be bolted to the bench. If you don't have the space for that, or frankly, if you don't have the money or the desire to spend that kind of money, you can do a lot of the same things with a half-inch cordless drill. Now, I recommend a cordless drill for doing this because the cordless drill is going to have the battery pack on the bottom, so you can set it down, hold it against the bench, and in one hand control the motor while using your other hand to control the tools that are cleaning up the head of the fastener. And we'll demonstrate that in just a minute. But while we're talking about cleaning stuff up, I've mentioned in the past that, here, I'm going to pull this one out. I don't think I've ever shown it. I've got it on a hanger here. I use a Dremel Model 732 flexible shaft tool. And I use this a lot, especially when I'm using wire brushes. In addition to the flexible shaft, I also have an abundance, and I mean a whole bunch, of different rotary tools. I keep one that's got nothing but a polishing wheel in it. I've got another one that I keep, well, this one's got a cup brush in it at the moment. Another one that I generally use with the Scotch-Brite wheels. At the moment, I'm only running two plus my flexible shaft tool. And my flexible shaft tool does not have variable speed, but this little box here that I picked up at Harbor Freight for like $18 will allow a non-variable speed brushed motor to get good variable speed control. So, yeah, that's an option. So anyway, I really do recommend, especially for certain operations, a flexible shaft tool be in your arsenal in addition to regular rotary tools. Some of the flexible shaft machines can get pretty darned expensive, but they're like everything else. A lot of the rotary tools can get pretty expensive. The Harbor Freight ones, which I run a bunch of these, I love them. These are like in the $25, $27 range, which are very affordable compared to, like, say, some of the Dremels that are $80, $90. Like I said, I've had this Dremel flexible shaft. I've had this thing for well over 30 years. Actually, closer to 35 years now. And I just recently had to rewire it. The power cord was starting to deteriorate. That's how long I've had it. But anyway, there are other flexible shafts out there that are not super expensive. If you want to spend the big money, you can buy something like a Fordham or whatever. But once again, I hate to keep on saying the words Harbor Freight. Harbor Freight has one in the $45 range, which is actually pretty nice. Once again, it's single speed, but with the addition of a little... this is actually a controller for a single speed router that doesn't have soft start. This won't work on something that has soft start circuitry in it or variable speed circuitry. This is something that's strictly just plug in and go. This could actually variable speed a sewing machine motor. So, yeah, not that you would use that to control a sewing machine. But if the motor has built-in soft start circuitry or something, you can't use that. But for our purposes here, it works just fine. So that's an option too. And you know, if you do a Google search for flexible shaft tools, or you go to a company like Micromark and you look through their power tools and you look for flexible shafts, you will find stuff all over the price spectrum. Point is, you don't need anything fancy. You really don't. There's only a couple of tools you're really going to be using where it's more advantageous to use a flexible shaft than it is a standard, you know, handheld type rotary tool. One area where I love using the flexible shaft, like I said, I use it mostly with wire brushes, is I use it with cut brushes to get inside the needle bar box and just power out all the schmoo that's in there on the inside surfaces. I do it a lot on featherweights, because, you know, featherweights get kind of gunky on the inside. The only thing you have to do is you have to be very, very careful that you don't let that wire wheel get outside and hit the paint. But you're going to have to be careful doing that regardless what you do. But 66s, 201s, 15s, I get in there and I get a lot of the crud out with the small wire cut brushes that come in these sets here that I pick up at Harbor Freight. These actually come with an end brush, two regular disc brushes, and two different sizes of cut brushes. So that's a five-piece set. They're like $5. I go through a ton of that stuff, but it works so, so well with a flexible shaft tool. And so that's why I wholeheartedly recommend that. There's a couple other tools you should know about for use with rotary tools. For example, I use a lot of these 1-inch diameter felt polishing wheels. You can get those in all sorts of different form factors. This most recent batch I got them in bulk, and they just screw onto the mandrel. They don't have a center hole. And as they wear out, I just take them off and throw them, and I pull another one out. Actually, I'm to the point now where I need to order more of these. I had been using a lot of this type here, and these are cotton wheels that uses a different style mandrel. These are stitched cotton wheels, and they have a center hole, and they use a mandrel that's got a little screw that goes through these. These work well, but you're going to make it snow inside. These things shed a lot, and frankly, they don't last as long as the felt ones do. The nice thing about the felt screw into the mandrels is they also are available in other shapes and sizes. And like I said, I get bunches of that stuff. I have mentioned in the past the rotary bits that are made out of like Scotch-Brite material. There's a set that has four different grits and four different colors. Various grits is the black, the yellow, the green, and the red, and there are different grits. I'll post the grit sizes over here. But anyway, these are available on Amazon. It's all going to be linked below. These things are great for quick removal of old baked-on crud. Works really, really well for that. And my favorite polishing points, I just actually started a new box recently. Let me get this one open. They come in these sets of 100. They're various sizes, various diameters. It's like 10 different sizes and diameters and shapes and different lengths and everything. These are hard felt. They work wonderfully with a standard rotary tool, and I use them with both white and yellow compound, mostly white because that's what I use mostly when I'm sitting here at the bench. Then there's these beasts, which I haven't shown these much. These are actually an abrasive impregnated rubber. These are good for grinding off material. They're not polishing. These are actually grinding points. I use these for certain things, deburring parts mostly. You won't see me using this very often on camera, but there's something I own a lot of. And then there's these beasties. These are 13/16 rotary diamond cutting discs. Once again, Harbor Freight. The set of five with a mandrel runs, I think, around $7 or something like that, maybe $8. These things are great for if you are making a, if you have to make a replacement release pin for an upper thread tension mechanism. These, if you take a number four finishing nail, a four penny finishing nail, excuse me, and you're taking the head off, the little head off, and you're taking the point off, and you're working the nail, these things are great for that. But regardless what kind of, tool you're using in your, what type of bit you have in your rotary tool or your flexible shaft or whatever, one rule applies. Regardless of what it is you're doing, if you've got something that's spinning, you're going to be wearing safety glasses, right? Nod your heads. Safety glasses are oh so very important. These little wire brushes, these things, they start shedding. They can mess you up. You get that hit in your eyes, it's big time problem. So always, always, always wear safety glasses. I have a pair of glasses that I call them my birth control glasses. They've got the side shields on them. They're prescription lenses, and they have side shields. All of my eyeglasses are ANSI approved safety glasses, but I do have a pair that has the side shields. I call them my birth control glasses for obvious reasons, but they have saved my eyes many, many times, both in here, in the wood shop, working on motorcycles. Anytime I'm working with a tool that might throw something, might cut a piece off of something and send that flying, I'm wearing safety glasses, and you should too. Anyway, let's move right along, and I mentioned that I'll show you how you can clean up chowdering on a screw head using a half-inch cordless drill. Let me demonstrate that. This is the mounting screw for the stitch length regulator of a an old Red Eye 66. I haven't done anything to clean it yet. It's as it came out of the machine. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to start off by chucking it into my Milwaukee 18-volt drill. I've got set on the high speed. I'm wearing safety glasses. Now the first thing, I took a piece of Scotch-Brite pad, and I use my utility scissors, and I cut down a strip. And the reason I do that is, number one, I buy this stuff in big 6x9 sheets, but Scotch-Brite is great for cleaning off a lot of crud and for getting inside here, underneath the lip, the end edge of the fastener. So we'll just fire up the drill and let the Scotch-Brite do some of its magic. Actually, what I'm going to do is I'm going to put a little bit of sewing machine oil on this just to lubricate it a little bit. Now you notice how I'm holding this. I'm holding it underneath the tool, underneath the hardware. So as it's spinning, if it catches, it's going to shoot it back towards my M&M with the saxophone there. Okay, I'm getting it up and into the bottom there, underneath. Okay, clean that off. Let me grab some paper towel. I'm just going to wipe this down. I'm not going to run the paper towel under power here. Okay, that cleaned off the majority of that schmoo. Back this off just a little bit. Okay, that's coming along nicely. I'll be able to clean up the rest of that later. So, first step, looking at the head of the screw, there's a lot of schmoo on there that's pretty dirty, but it's not really ground up. But we're going to pretend for a moment that the screw head here is a little chowdered. So I'm going to take a really coarse a nail file. These are the foam cord nail files.
And if the slot of this screw was badly chowdered up, this would be cleaning that up nicely. And as you can see here, it's taking a lot of the crud off of that. Taking most of the crud off. Now we'll take, and I'll use the coarser of the, there's, these things are two different, this particular ones, the blue and the pink, have two different coarsenesses. The side that doesn't have the printing is 320 on this. The side with the printing is 220, and it's 320, and then it's 400, and then 600. So we'll take the coarser of the two sides. Yeah, see, it chewed that a little bit. There is something on there. So we'll take that. We'll take the coarser one once again. And just get whatever that is that's causing that to catch. Grind that off. Okay, we'll go back to the blue. You always go coarser first. And then go with your finer. Now once again, I'll go coarser. This is like a 400 grit on this side, a 600 grit on this side. Now this one has 600, 600, I think this is 8,000. What's it say here? And then the face is 12,000. So we'll just real quick touch it off. And just give it a little bit more polish. And that is completely respectable. Now, if we want to go and really go nuts on this, we grab our Engineer PZ56 pliers. Actually, let's open that up. And we can hold our screw repair pliers. A little bit of white compound. And you can really go nuts if you really, really want to. You don't have to by any stretch of the imagination. But if you want to, you can easily make it look like that. And my God, is that warm. Hoo boy. Anyway, other things. Okay, here is the reverse threaded screw that holds the linkages for the needle bar clamp. Or I should say the take-up linkages, not needle bar clamp. Once again, if these often get chowdered, and a lot of times I'll open up a machine and that's already pre-chowdered for me. So, a nail file to clean up the chowdering, and then clean it the rest of the way. Completely with a drill, not using the fancy stuff at all. And actually, I need a little bit more on this. This is very doable, guys. Okay, that's coming along nicely. What's making this doable with a small drill motor versus a big bench motor is we're going at slow speed. We don't need, you know, super high speed to do that. And there you go. It didn't look like that coming out of Singer's factory. But anyway, so yeah, you can do it with a regular drill. That small buffing motor with the drill chuck on it from Karen's email, that's not going to have the torque. A drill like this, this is geared. That's not a geared motor. This is going to, you can get away with it with a motor like this because there's a gear, there's gearing between the motor and the chuck. That other bench motor, I use the term loosely, calling that a bench motor, that's just on the motor shaft. There's no gearing there. There's no torque multiplication. It ain't going to work. This works great. I should also mention, I've had this particular Milwaukee cordless drill. Oh, I'm going to say it's at least a dozen years old. It's done just about everything you can possibly imagine. And, it's holding up beautifully. So, take it for what it's worth. But along those lines now, I want to talk once again about pliers for work holding. The PZ56, the PZ57s from Engineer, and these PZ60s needle nose are all outstanding for working on hardware. They're originally designed for extracting broken screw heads, or I should say, extracting screws from electronic devices and stuff, because they can grab chowdered up screw heads and get things out. But they also work beautifully when you're doing repair work on a fastener. For example, if, let me pull this one out again. Say, for example, if this head were, if the slot on this head were damaged, we could easily grip this and then use our rotary tool with one of those cutters to work that slot and clean it up, or you saw me doing it for polishing. So yeah, I wholeheartedly recommend getting at least the PZ56 and the PZ57s. That would be, this is the 56, this is the 57s. But if you can get the, if you can also get the 60s, I recommend these as well. These are all phenomenal, and my opinion, must-haves for doing any kind of work on these machines.
Back into the mailbag, Constance commented on the video, Singer 99 versus 221 Featherweight, does it need the case, referring to the 99, can I sew with it on a flat surface, no base case? Constance, no. 66s and 99s need to be either A, in a cabinet, or B, in a case. The reason is the way the mechanism is down below, it will be interfering with the table surface. It doesn't have standalone legs like you might find on, say, a 201. So it needs a base. If you need to find a base, there's a gentleman who sells utility-grade bases on eBay at a pretty reasonable price. I think ones for a 3/4 size machine are like about $40 or so. They're not super pretty, but they do come with lollipop hinges, and a lot of people buy them and they'll like decoupage them or work them up, whatever. I've bought several of them. I've used them on many different machines. They work just fine. Okay, Jodi writes, this email, the subject was wiring skews from McMaster. Hey there, Mr. Bob. Thank you for all the time and effort to teach the world how to restore these beautiful machines. Over the past 20 years, I've watched many technical videos, and you are one of the best. Why, thank you, Jodi. I recently acquired a 201-2, and I'm ready to rewire. Do you have the skews for the wire that you buy from McMaster? Note, if your view count has exponentially jumped this month, it's me. Kind regards, Jodi. Jodi, I don't buy my wire from McMaster. What I buy from McMaster is my shrink tubing and my grommets. Wire, I actually get stuff that's called Stinger. I buy it at my local electronics supplier, but it is available online. Unfortunately, I think it's pretty much only available in really, really long spools. Like, I buy white, yellow, red, and black, but they're in like 500-foot spools. So, I have considered possibly starting offering wire available to people. I've got, contact me and we'll talk, but, because I know not everybody's going to want to spend $40 to buy a 500-foot spool. But I haven't started doing that yet, but I'm considering doing that, offering like 10-foot lengths. So, and it would be 10 foot of at least the three yellow, black, and red, because on our Singer three-position wiring blocks, that's what they're color-coded is. You know, pin number one is yellow, pin two is black, pin three is red. So, like, when I'm doing a light, because lights go to pins one and three, I use a yellow and a red wire. When I'm doing a motor, because motors go to pins two and three, I do a black and a red. So, foot controllers, not so much, because those are generally done up with lamp cord. But I do put a piece of yellow tape on the pin that goes to number one. But anyway, yeah, so I'll put a link to the grommets and the shrink tube that I use for McMaster. Okay, Melinda writes, Bob, this was, she's talking about a 192K and it's felt oil wick. She goes, thanks very much for responding to my comment on your video for the 192K basic cleaning. I've taken the bobbin holder out and cleaned it all, but didn't remove the lift button bar, not sure of the correct wording, well, it's the bobbin case positioning bracket. I'm including a pic of the inside next to the bobbin push button. I'll put that picture up here. Let me see. I'm not seeing a small clogged hole anywhere on this side. When I cleaned the area under the presser foot behind the bobbin, there was a small amount of blackened old felt wedged in there, attached to nothing. It was just lodged into the corner towards the front side of the machine. Any insight would be appreciated. Some other thoughts. Can I cut my own felt circles? I do leatherwork and have the tools, blah, blah, blah. Okay. Do you sell the base box? No, but I'll have a link down below to Dwayne's. You recommended replacing the foot pedal. My original seems to be working well, but we'll take your advice if you think necessary. After watching a number of your videos, I cleaned up my old Spartan and it's working smoothly. Thank you for creating those, etc., etc., etc. All right, Melinda. The blackened old felt wedged in, we call that probably, it's probably about 3 mu of lint. And an MU meaning a mouse unit, and, well, at least Joe Mercer and I call it a mouse unit. A mouse unit being enough lint to make the yarn to knit a sweater for a field mouse. 5 mus generally is an RU, a rat unit. And if you have 2 rat units, that's enough to do a New York City sewer rat sweater. But yeah, what you had there was just junk. However, now I've never seen a 192 that didn't have a spring for an oil wick, but you sent me a photograph. There's none there. So yeah, I'm suspecting that your machine was probably towards the end of a production run, perhaps, or maybe somebody put a different bobbin case positioning bracket in, which I doubt. But yeah, they normally have them. If you don't have it, just make sure you put a drop of oil on the top of the hook. Just put a drop right where the push button is for the bobbin release. You know, whenever you oil your machine, it's odd, but you know, towards the end of production runs, Singer did all sorts of stuff to reduce expenses and reduce costs. So I'm assuming that's what it is. it should work just fine without it. I see so many 66s and 99s that do have the facilities for the oil wick, where the oil wick has been long gone and nobody ever changed it. They work just fine. They just get a little bit noisier is all. Okay, as far as, do you recommend replacing the foot pedal? That depends. If your machine has a 3-pin connector already on it, yeah, go ahead, put a different foot pedal on, get the one that's built into the power cord. If you've got a regular resistive type foot pedal and it's in good shape, you know, don't go crazy. Because otherwise you're going to have to do some other rewiring underneath the motor. If you want to talk about it more, I sent you an email with my phone number. We can chat about it. So, see, did I miss anything? No, I think we got it all. Cutting your own felt circles, I presume you mean for spool pins? Yeah, sure. Or you can be like my wife and you can crochet one. I mean, if you know how to crochet, that is. But yeah, you can do. And as far as felt for those, I've seen them anywhere from, you know, really hard, thick felt to super soft. So yeah, felt is felt. It doesn't matter. You don't have to. I mean, they're a consumable. So anyway, moving right along. Sheryl writes, in your show today, you talked about rewiring a 101 to eliminate the Chicago-style plugs. I have a Graybar that uses these as well. Okay, there's photos coming up. Lost the plug-in cord in a move. Could you provide the process for rewiring this machine to use a standard 3-wire plug and electronic foot controller? The machine turns easily, has a 90-watt motor that can be used with AC or DC. Years before moving, I know it was working well in AC mode. The foot controller was the old rheostat style and looked like it had asbestos insulation. Tried making a cord with a Chicago-style connector for boats, but it smoked the rheostat. Here's the picture of what she means by smoked it. Yeah, that's cooked. Then bought an electronic foot controller and wired it to the same cord, but I think I killed it. Hopefully the motor is still okay. No signs of shorts in the electrical wiring when using a tester. Appreciate any help you can provide. Thank you, Sheryl. Well, Sheryl, doesn't matter who makes the machine. The wiring is pretty much going to be the same on all of them. But we'll use the Singer as an example. The Singer 3-wire connector, pins 1, 2, and 3, pins 1 and 3 is where the AC line voltage is coming in. And yes, on a non-Singer machine, you certainly can use one of the, they're in the cabinet. You certainly can use a Singer-style connector if you so desire. But it's not necessarily required. But it does make life a little bit easier. Anyway, power's going in on pins 1 and 3. The way Singer does it, the light, including the switch, when I say the light, I'm going to mean, say, the light and its switch, whether the switch is in the light head or if there is an external switch to the light. But the light goes to pins 1 and 3 also. So it's directly across the AC, the input AC. The foot controller goes between pins 1 and 2. Okay? So 1 and 2 is foot controller. The motor goes between pins 2 and 3. So what's happening here is the foot controller and the motor are wired in series. Pin 2 is just a terminal to connect the motor and the foot controller together. So you're putting that across the AC circuit so that when you step on the foot controller, it allows current to flow through, bada bing, bada boom, the motor spins. Okay? And you can do this with any sewing machine. Now, what I would recommend in the case of your non-Singer, I would rewire the motor so that you have a piece of cord coming out with a regular household plug on it. And for the lamp, you have a cord coming out with a regular household plug on it. Because what you can get is a modern electronic controller that has a little duplex receptacle wired into the block. And one will be labeled motor, and one will be labeled lamp or light. So you plug the light into the light, you plug the motor into the motor. Now, I showed a while ago how you can make one of those yourself. I did it for a woman who I redid a Bamberger's vibrating shuttle machine for her. And in her cabinet, I built one. I built one from scratch using a regular duplex receptacle, except it didn't have the grounding plugs. But I showed how to make that using a duplex receptacle and a surface mount box. I'll link that video down below as well. I think that's part of another video, but I'll link it to where it starts. That would be my recommendation rather than using the Singer three-prong connector. First of all, you would have to figure out how to mount that three-prong connector onto the machine, which probably wouldn't work. But by using the standard foot controller with a duplex outlet on it, and like I said, these things are wired in a specific way so that one side is always hot across the power, the other one, it's wiring so that the foot controller, which is attached to it, is in series with the motor. Using that is just so much simpler. It saves a heck of a lot of aggravation, and all you have to worry about is wire on the motor coming out, going to a plug, wire on the lamp coming out, going to a plug. Before we go, the campaign that we're running right now to support the Pet Adoption Network of New Jersey, it's still going through the end of November. 100% of the proceeds, 100% of all profits from our merch store is going directly to the Pet Adoption Network of New Jersey. So far we've raised around $300 or so last time I looked, but anyway, there have been people who have asked me, hey, Bob, you know, I don't need any more coffee cups, I don't need t-shirts, I don't need tote bags. How can I help? Well, you certainly can. If you want, you can send a check to Pet Adoption Network, Post Office Box 203, Red Bank, New Jersey, 07701. So any amount, big or small, feel free. We greatly appreciate anything that you can donate. Like I said, all profits from our merch store will be going there. Once we have, you know, the end of the month, we know how much we made. We're going to be cutting a check and giving it to them. They are at our local PetSmart in Homedale, New Jersey, on every Saturday. Liz and I were there today. And they still have a lot of kittens. A lot of adult cats, too, but they still have a lot of kittens from this kitten season. This was an inordinately busy kitten season for them. And assuming that they get most of these kittens adopted by the end of the year, they're only going to have like a three-month respite before the new kitten season starts. So, yeah, do whatever you can to help. We greatly appreciate it. But anyway, that's what I've got for you this week. Thank you so much for watching. For those of you who have contributed to Pet Adoption Network, we thank you so much, and we will see you on the next one.